الله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه وذريته وتسليما كثيرا. أما بعد, beloved brothers and sisters, we welcome you today with an open discussion with our good Sheikh, Sheikh Muhammad Said Adli. We also have a guest with us, Brother Kaleem, who we all three traveled from South Carolina to North Carolina to visit the good brothers in Islamic Center of Greensboro. So at this time, the Sheikh and myself, we were discussing that there was an interesting conversation we had as we were coming up to North Carolina. And this discussion revolved around some of the things that the Muslims are concerned with and face with in our daily lives, especially in the worldly affairs when it comes to business, when it comes to monetary transaction. So our good brother Kaleem, who's here with us, who asked certain questions, which inshallah we would like our brother Kaleem to please return those questions back to us, so we can inshallah have the good Sheikh answer those questions inshallah.
Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum. The issue that we was dealing with is the issue of riba and the accessibility of riba in the business transactions here in America. I'm in the process of establishing an Islamic barber school targeting the young Muslims in our community, and in the establishment of this business, I was offered a loan by a state agency, and it made it appear that since the interest rates were so small that the riba issue would not be a question. And so I was asking the imam, what is the dalil on the issue of riba when it comes to business transactions here in America?
Well, this question is a very important question, and we like to inshallah embark on this topic. So if you would allow me, I would like the audience to get some idea of the topic that we're going to talk about in relation to your question. So a good brother, he asked the question regarding, he was about to open up a business, and in that business, the state offered him a loan. And the loan was given by a condition that he had to pay back the interest. And the state, they tried to make him understand, because they understood that the Muslim faith are not allowed to have transaction with interest, riba. They tried to convince him by saying that the riba is so minuscule that it really doesn't matter if you pay back this loan with such small amount of interest. So with that, the good Sheikh, how are you today? The trip was inshallah good.
Alhamdulillah, and we're talking about 1:40 a.m. in the morning. I don't know what kind of recording that we can be doing in such a time like this.
Well, inshallah, Fajr time is coming very soon.
Alhamdulillah, but I think inshallah the time, as long as we're occupying it in the cause of Allah, so it doesn't matter what time it is.
So tell us, what is actually riba?
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. The word riba, which is an Arabic term, means min raba yarbu, that means something to increase. The Islamic ruling that kullu qardin jalaba naf'an fahuwa riba, any loan that bring about beneficial or benefit that he withdrew as a result of this loan, this it became an interest or a usury. So Islam always encourages that Muslims help one another. Doesn't matter if you're Muslim or non-Muslims, that for people to be concerned about assisting one another. But when you're doing this, you're doing it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not that you looking for getting any benefit other than the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you're giving me $1,000 and you're expecting me to return it to you $1,000 and 10, this what the $10 is a interest, is a riba, is a usury. As a result of this is not acceptable in an Islam. You are not obligated to give somebody money as a loan. If you want to assist to him, alhamdulillah, but if you don't want to give him, so you are not been blamed, you lost the reward. But whenever you give it to a person, you could not be expecting, neither you can make agreement with him that this will be returned with increase. It have to be the same principles that have been given. So this is what we're talking about, interest or riba. It does not have to be money. As example, I give you $1,000, when you return it to me, it have to be $1,000, could not be $1,000 and couple apples or a bag of oranges, okay? You give me a certain number, certain items, I give you the same thing exactly. Nothing addition to this. To such a degree that some of the righteous people in the early time, when they walk by somebody that they lend him money and it's too hot out in the street, they did not even sit beside the wall because they, out of conscience that maybe the shade that coming out of the wall, it can be counted as a form of interest, that something you benefit, that you're taking advantage of him now because you lend him the money, now you can have this privilege that you can sit beside the wall and get some shade.
So you use certain terminologies, riba, usury, interest. Most common people really do not hear this word usury. So are you saying the word usury and interest are the same? And are there any other terms in the market that are being used to refer to the same thing?
To be honest with you, I'm not that professional in the language. So I'm not going to claim to be the alim, allama, mufti, fahama that knows everything, okay? I only talk about what I know. Is interest and usury are equivalent to each other or not? I don't know. But I know what is the word in Arabic, which riba is.
Okay.
But since I've been in America and dealing with people, all what I hear, usury or interest. So maybe you can help us.
We hear the words like finance charge. Is this also part of riba? There's fees. I mean, are these words interchangeable? Because we understand, as you define the word riba, taking any increase amount from the principal amount is considered as
riba. A result of giving the loan. But for me to process something that I need to make a Xerox copy, it costs 5 cents. I need to do this thing. This is something as a cost, as a understand to send the money to. Let's say that you in New York and I am in South Carolina. For me to mail it, now this is 44 cent stamp or 43, I don't know. 44 cent stamp, okay? This is something I understand, I'm not responsible about it. So if I'm asking you for the stamp, for the envelope, to send this a check, this is something totally
different. So this is a fee.
This is something for, I'm giving you $1,000, okay? So I'm expecting from you $1,000. And I could not count, neither I can make agreement, and you can be wrong, I can be wrong, to accept or to write or to even witness this kind of agreement.
Okay. So now we understand that interest, riba, usury that you have defined. Do you find, being here in the United States, that there's a common transaction amongst the Muslims and the non-Muslims, that they are involved in this type of transaction? If so, how?
Like I said, I don't deal with economics, okay? But in same time, I'm well acquainted with the principles in Islam. How the people conducted, the basic is that there is a principle. The principles that what I give you, this what I deserve to take back. Other than this, not, unless that was a cost for this money to reach to your place.
So that brings our question of a good brother giving an example of type of a transaction existing in the society where someone wants to give a loan to someone to do business or open up a school or buy a property. Mm. And in turn, the promissory note says that you will give me back, let's say, $100,000, which I lent you. On top of that, you give me 0.5%.
For what?
For that amount which I gave you.
For lending you the money?
Yeah.
Not for processing, sending the money,
no,
not for anything.
No, the basic
this
principle.
What I'm talking about. This is a problem here. You getting money due to the fact you lend me money.
Okay.
Not for any other reason. I can be sitting here, sitting beside you. There is no even another agent between me and you. I'm giving you here the money in your hand. There is not even an envelope. There is no a stamp to send you the check, nothing. I'm giving it to you here in your hand. Why I'm going to take $100,000 plus? This plus for what reason? You asking this due to the fact you lend me the money. That means you're taking advantage of my case.
But as we know, money transaction, inflation goes up and down. And dollar value is based on that. So the lender is actually pre-calculating that due to inflation,
mm-hmm.
he's already putting a certain stipulation that, okay, you know what, you're holding my money is working with you.
Mm-hmm.
So because the dollar, which is valued today, is not going to be the same tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
So I need this extra amount. So what is wrong with that?
Okay, what is guarantee that always inflation? Can it go down or can always go up?
Well, America's always going up.
No, I'm not worried about what America goes up or down. I'm asking you, can we make an agreement that if the $100, the purchase power, if this is the term they're using, the purchasing power,
mm-hmm.
today, after 10 years, is different. This is a different story. So now when you give me $100,000, after 10 years, the $100,000 could not buy what I can buy today.
But Imam, so,
okay, but excuse me for a moment, okay? So now, you always count that we're going up. What about if we go down? Are you going to deduct, as example, $200 or $500 because the value went down?
Well, that's an investment transaction. For the audience,
we
are trying to give certain questions to the Sheikh because, not to be a devil's advocate, but these are some of the arguments that the people use to get themselves involved in the interest and usury and riba. Is this correct, Brother?
Yes, and excuse me. One thing that I would like to interject is, what is the condition under which it would become necessary for a business owner to accept the contract and agree to pay the small interest rate? Given an example, here you have several kids that need an education or vocational trade so that they can provide for their families. And the only way this can be done is that you have to establish the training facility, and the only way you can get it is by accepting the loan to build the school to train the kids. Now, under what condition do you go to what extent to say, no, you still can't accept the loan? Or is it dire? Is it necessary? Is it become so serious now that you must engage in the RIBA transaction? Under what condition, to what extent do you
make the haram halal?
Yeah, make the haram halal.
This is a very good question, but before that, Chief, you were mentioning something about accepting money on the basis of if there's a loss, the person will take a loss. If there's a gain, the person will take a gain. This is not an investment. It is what they're saying is that, for an example, buying a house, it seems in the market generally, the real estate prices usually go up. So the man is giving you $100,000 to buy a house. What's worth today is not going to be worth the same 10 years from now. So he's saying, listen, I'm lending you this money. My money is working with you. So after a certain period of time, I like to get my money back plus some goodly addition to that.
Okay.
So what is wrong with that type of concept? And this is the same type of concept. We have many Muslim organizations under the name of Guidance, under the name of La Riba. In, I don't want to go into details about their system, but they're basically saying the same thing.
Okay, so you're assuming that I'm going to make a profit?
Yeah.
What about if I didn't do profit?
This is the chance you have to take because you're working with my money.
Okay, so now are you lending me money or you coming as an investment?
I'm lending you money with some interest.
You see, when Bani Israel, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbid for them, you understand, to eat the fat. So they went and they melted it. That means they put it in a different form and they sold it. Or when Allah forbid for Bani Israel to fish on the Saturday, the Sabbath. So they went Friday and they bought the net. So when the fish come in, okay, the net will hold it. They don't go and take it Saturday, but they will pick it up Sunday. So if we're going to make what you call hiyal, that means tricks, to play games with the law of Allah, Allah would curse us like he cursed the Jews. So the issue here, you understand, are you in investment with me? Are you as a partner? If I profit, you profit. If I lose, you lose. Or are you lending me money?
No, I'm lending you money. I'm so lending you money, and I want a 0.5% at the end.
For
of
what? That. For what? What did you do?
My money. I worked hard for my money.
So nobody put a gun in your head and they said you have to give me money.
But
you
I
don't
need
want
money.
To give it to me for a good cause and for Allah to reward you for it.
Well,
so don't do it.
Non-Muslim is not worried about Allah or the
So
hereafter.
Why we have to turn to non-Muslims? Why even have we have to have that business?
Because we live in their land and the Muslims
will show wait. So you try to tell me, you try to open a business. I want to ask you, what are you doing now? Are you working?
Yes.
Are you
generally?
So I'm going to borrow $100,000 so I can open me a store. You know, for you to open the store, to get the license, all these things, it takes about preparation. Between 2 to 6 months preparation and getting everything ready. What are you doing this moment? You're doing some kind of work to feed your family, is it? Yes or no?
Well, I assume the person is.
Of course, yeah. Okay. So now, that means you are not content with the little bit that you're making now. You try to be bigger, okay? But bigger in the cause of the Islam, in cause of your aqidah, not in anything else. So for me to be rich, okay, I'm going to break the law of Allah. I'm not worried about you, understand. Do you have enough? Okay, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying what the meaning is that man asbaha aminan fi sirbi, mu'afan fi badani, indahu qutu yawmi, faqad hizat lahu ad-dunya. Whosoever in the morning that he safe in his house, in his apartment, in his tent, whatever where he live, if he woke up in the morning and you are safe and secure in your tent, okay, and you are healthy in your body and you have the provision of that day, you are a possessor of all this material thing. So our problem as Muslims in general that we are greedy even in the cost of our for sacrificing our Islam. The problem is that we don't have, no, we are having something but we want to more. Nothing wrong to get more, but you get it from halal or don't do it.
But Sheikh, you see, as our viewers, most of them, they are very much concerned that they're living in the United States.
What does the United States have to do with this?
I will tell you. So as we are living in this country, we have to show our existence, our presence.
Existence. We need to show our existence to Allah, not to America.
I understand, but you see, because we are here in a non-Muslim land, and we are here to establish and let the people know that we exist and we have monetary positions, we have...
Let me tell you one, excuse me, I'm sorry to cut you off. Mm-hmm. You're never ever going to be as much as American person. Smart, in economic, in their building, all this. You're not going to be one like them, okay? So what you're competing with them is something they already study it and they born and raised in it and they already know it to do it while they close their eyes. Now you think you're going to prove your existence by building another house, by opening another factory? They're doing it. You are not proving anything to them. And why I'm so concerned about proving to the people, I can do what you do. You have something unique that they are not doing it. And this is believing in Allah and following the law of Allah. If you are failure in it, you are failing in everything else. So don't tell me about what I'm going to do to show the American people. What about when you go to China? What about when you go on the moon? What are you going to be doing? So every day you keep it changing. You are not having a foundation to stand on it, so you keep it changing.
So trying to become one of the people in this land, even if we have to take some riba, are you saying that this is something that is reprehensible in Islam? Because, you know, it's known that from many.
You want to be American or you want to be a Muslim?
Not me, I'm just expressing. I'm talking on behalf of the common Muslims who have.
So you became the lawyer of these common Muslims?
No, sir.
Balil insanu ala nafsi basira wa alqa ma'adira. Okay? What we're trying to show the American, we need to show Allah our purity, our obedience. This is what we have to be concerned about. If we do this, Allah will change our condition. For years and years and years, we're trying to show America and China and. You still Bin Laden, you still a terrorist, you're still fundamental, you're still a Wahhabi, okay? Doesn't matter, you shave your beard, or your wife is going to walk naked, or you understand you're going to open the riba bank, it's not going to, you're still a Muslim, okay? And this is the way, how is it going to view you? Doesn't matter how much you're going to build.
So in other words, you're saying, no matter how ever we try to establish ourselves, we should always try to do it in a halal way without getting involved at all.
Yes. What does it mean to establish? Establish, what is establishment, akhi? The term establishment, what does it mean? Establishing, number one, you don't establish yourself. Allah will establish you. Allah is saying, الَّذِينَ إِمَّا كَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. The tamkeen and the authority comes as a gift from Allah when you became true Abdullah and Amatullah. Allah will give you tamkeen. Allah will give you establishment in the earth. But and Allah said, those who carry our command, we will give them establishment in the earth. And after this, what? أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ وَآتَوُوا الزَّكَاةِ وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَنَهُوا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. How are you going to establish yourself in America or in the moon, wherever it is, and you are in a war with Allah?
But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also said in the Quran that He does not change the state of the people hatta yughayyiru ma bi anfusihim, unless they start to change within themselves. So with this, we have to make certain changes. Now, in the subject of riba, excuse me, sir, I mean, we do understand it's haram. But we do also understand there's those individuals, some scholars, they say that taking riba is different from giving riba. You see? So okay. There's many people who buys houses, businesses, they're not taking riba from the people, but they're actually paying the riba. So this is not the same. Can you enlighten us into the difference between the two?
Okay, who says that the giver is different from the receiver? Who said it?
There's many people.
The scholars, okay, but the scholars, did they back up what they're saying with evidence from Quran or Hadith?
I don't know.
The Prophet, you don't know?
No, I'm saying okay. What the people's concerns are.
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying what the meaning is. La'anallahu akil al-riba wa muwakkilu wa shahidai. Okay? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the curse of Allah upon the person who giving usury, the person who receiving the usury, the witnesses who write the usury. Everybody's cursed. The Prophet ﷺ said only the giver, only the receiver, even the witnesses. A Muslim, a true Muslim could not work in any usury institution, not even working as a security guard, not even as sweeping the floor.
You mean working in the bank, a person is not allowed
of
to
Of course,
work
it's haram.
It's haram. Even yes. Clean the bathroom?
Even cleaning the bathroom, okay?
SubhanAllah.
Because Allah, I don't care. I know what Allah is saying. Listen.
Many Muslims who's working in the financial institution.
I tell you one thing, okay? The action of the people is not evidence. It's the Quran is what's
no,
evidence.
No, it's scary for us because there's many Muslims working in the financial institution.
Now, they need to make tawbah. They need to make tawbah and go back to Allah. The principle of Islam is saying, وَتَعَوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. Help one another towards righteousness and good deed, and do not assist one another towards sin and disobedience.
But Imam, there's so many Muslims now in the financial institution. What's the solution for them in this land?
May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open their eyes to see the truth, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them a tawbah insha'Allah. Akhi, listen what Allah is saying. Listen to Allah first before we talk about scholars said and many people. Allah is saying, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, ittaqullah, fear Allah. وَذَرُوا مَا بَقِيَ مِنَ الرِّبَى إِن كُنْتُ مُؤْمِنِينَ. Leave alone dealing with interest, usury, riba, if you are believers. Okay, if you are believers, this is a condition. So if you don't have the true faith, this is a problem. And he said, فَإِن لَمْ تَفَعَلُوا, that if you don't stop dealing with usury, فَأَذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, be ready with a war between you and Allah is in His messenger. So most of the Muslims nowadays, governments, families, individuals, even some Islamic centers, they are in a war with Allah. How they can be successful? And you tell me they're going to establish themselves and show the American people that we are can do this and that. You show me one masjid similar to any of these churches, okay? They building, they do everything. Who could not, ya akhi? This dunya is jannatul kafir wa sijnul muslim. Al-dunya sijnul mu'min wa jannatul kafir. The life, temporary life, this hayatul dunya, is a jail for the believer, paradise for the disbelievers. We could not compete with them about dunya. You really want to compete with them? Compete with them in halal.
So if a person's son is in the hospital and they need a very severe an operation,
okay,
which is a life-death situation,
mm-hmm,
and they're not able to afford to do it,
okay,
or a person, as our good brother mentioned, opening up a business where this may be a means, bi-ithnillah, to teach other people to have vocational skills. In what cases, or what case, riba can become halal for the people? Because nowadays we find everyone making it halal, even to the point, as we know, some of the scholars have said, in credit cards you can have a credit card as long as you use it at a time of emergency. So can you enlighten us in the times or the situations that a person can involve themselves into
riba? What do you think Islam came for? Islam came is to save our life, to save our dignity, our honor, our religion. So Islam is concerned about you. Islam is not going to see you dying until you die. No. When there is a case of emergency, this is something else. As long as there is alternative, you could not go to usury. As long as there is alternative. But let's say that you understand, like you say, somebody, his son, and the hospital in emergency, and he have to borrow $20,000, otherwise they are not going to do the operation. This is a different case. If the Muslim could, he don't have it, he don't have something to put it as a cradle, okay, or how you say?
Collateral.
Yes, mm-hmm. Or he could not find anybody to lend him this money, and this is the only choice, and this to save the life of his son. This is something different. But somebody want to expand his business. Somebody want to open, you understand, a new business. No, you be satisfied with the little business you're doing, and this is it. So emergency case, فَمَنُ اضطُرَّ غَيْرَ بَاغٍ وَلَا عَادٍ. Okay? فَمَنُ اضطُرَّ. So if there is a case of emergency or a necessity, you're driven by a necessity. Now, the haram does not become halal, but become exception now, okay? But what is this Muslim that they have this kind of case? Why are you buying a house? Oh, because this man, you understand, I've been here in America for 20 years. He just been here for 5 years and bought this house. Now my wife keep complaining, I have to show her I'm going to... No, as long as you can rent the apartment, you are not halal for you to go get a house from riba. Why? Because there is an alternative. But now, if I could not find an apartment, and now they're going to throw me in the street, me and my kids, and now DSS will come get involved, take my children, put them, you understand, in an adoption house, this is a different story. because now no landlord want to give me apartment because I have 7 kids, as example. So now I have no choice, and if I wait, they kick me out of the house. Nobody want to give me a house to rent, and now the church will get involved, the government getting involved, the DSS get involved. My children now going to the church. It's a different story. But now I understand, because somebody came after me to America. He been here for 5 years and now he have a house. And I've been here for 20 years and don't have a house. Now I should buy a house. This is nonsense.
So tell us, credit cards. Tell us some things about credit card. Because credit card is a very common, I'll use term as, like drinking water in this society. And every Muslim desires to have one. So when is a credit card allowed to have? Or are we allowed to have the credit card? Because from what I understand what you're saying, that our viewers may try to take understanding, is that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in hadith which is sahih, that he said, the one who takes riba, the one who gives, one who takes and the one who gives,
and the one who witnesses, everybody.
One who witnesses and the one who signs a contract on interest. Correct?
Everybody involved,
right.
Anybody.
All four of these people, they're all cursed by Allah Azza wa Jalla. And we know in credit cards, you know, before you get the credit card, you must sign a contract stating that if you do not pay the amount of money which you spent on that credit card before its due date, you will have to pay such and such amount of interest. Mm-hmm. Now, Muslims say that, you know, I have this credit card, I paid on time, so, you know, it's not a crime upon me, I am safe from the curse of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Could you please elaborate on
that? This is not true. And this is not my opinion, and this is the fatwa of Sheikh Abdul Aziz ibn Baz, rahmatullah alayhi, may Allah send mercy on him.
Amen.
Because you had agreed to the principles of the contract, that if you did not pay in time, they will charge you interest. Mm-hmm. So you still involved in something not acceptable in Islam. And the problem nowadays, that like you say, you find the person is not understand, have one credit card, you have 8 credit cards. For what? Maybe credit card is a must for you, but it's not a must for me. You're a businessman traveling every day up and down from the East Coast to the China to the moon down. And I'm person, my job, round the corner from my house. Okay, I don't go anywhere. 60, 70 years old, I don't have any need for any of these things. So it may be to somebody became as emergency, and to somebody is nothing. So why? But still the bottom line, the credit card, for those who sign for credit card, they are indulged in some kind of usury with no doubt.
That's interesting you say that. Then our viewers might be thinking, if this is the case, then we should take all of our monies from the bank out from our checking account. Because
I know what you're aiming to.
In the so bank account,
you try to find all this.
No, this is
so people say, "Oh, forget it, man! This man making everything haram, haram, haram." So you try to find a way that the people don't listen to what I'm talking about.
I'm trying to.
We are not here. I'm not shame or shy or embarrassed to say what Islam is about. And don't think Islam, you understand, like eating a piece of candy. Okay, you want to go to Jannah? Okay, you have to make some sacrifice.
But I have to go to the bank and put my money in there. And they're going to use my money. I know FDIC every day is going to give the bank X amount of money in interest because of the amount of money they have in their bank.
Okay.
So now, I'm not going to put my money in under my mattress. Okay. I need to put my money, my millions of dollars that I'm earning.
Okay.
And I must take it and put it in the bank.
Okay, let me ask a simple question. First of all, when you try to break the limits of Allah, you don't have the fear of Allah anymore. So now Allah will put the fear of everything in your heart. Why the thief knows that so-and-so have $1 million? And why, what's made going to him to know that he have it under your mattress? So now became my fear, you understand, is the money. And now my fear is a man that going to break inside my house. How he knows that I'm a rich man? But let's assume this, okay? You have to deal with the bank. Let's assume this. What about me? why I have to put my money in the bank? You have millions of dollars. All what I have, $5,000. So why I'm putting my money? Do you think the bank has his own money? The bank take his money, your money, my money, and out of this money, you go give this person a loan. So if you and me and him did not give the bank, put our money in the bank, how is the bank going to make give a loan to somebody else? So you are assisting the bank, directly or indirectly, to be a loaner, or what you call it, to provide loan to others. Is this true?
But you
assist him.
But I mean, I think the circumstances in this country is kind of different, because if I save my money under my mattress,
okay,
and I come up with $20,000, okay, $30,000,
okay,
and I go buy a car,
okay,
then you have the IRS coming to me and the FBI now asking, where is all this cold cash coming from?
Okay, good. Are you requested by the government that you have to put your money in the bank, or you requested that you have record and receipts from where you got the money?
The record and receipts.
So this is two different stories. Don't mix and understand eggs and pineapple and pancake together. I know I say oranges and apples, but I like to have my own.
I don't know what is a pancake. What's a pancake? I know a pancake.
Okay, yeah, whatever. Okay, let's go to
oranges. I thought you said pancake, huh? I thought pancake. Okay,
thank you.
I'm glad that you know a little bit about the government that require receipts and records. Yes. They are not require where you put in your money.
I understand.
Let me ask you a question.
Sure.
What is stopping you to buy a safe deposit box, or what they call a safe? You know a safe?
Yes.
That a big thing that made out of metal, so heavy, and you bought it in your house and you put the money in it.
Nothing.
You tell me, how's it going to break this? What? How's it going to carry it?
Depends.
Let's assume this, okay?
It depends on their profession, you see. If they went to the school of Fort Knox, you know, then
Fort
Knox.
Okay.
They know how to break into these things, but of course that's just a fat chance. But
okay.
Anyway,
all right.
I appreciate your answer.
Do you know in the bank there is something for your knowledge?
Yes.
Called a safe deposit box.
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
You can rent it.
Yes.
So your money is still inside. Nobody else using it except you, but you are giving the bank $100,000, which is lend it to other people. Okay, or lend part of it, and they're making money of it. How is a bank can have money if you don't give him money?
This is right. So in other words, you're saying now...
So finally, I say something.
Well,
right.
I'm trying to summarize it for the viewers, because there's many questions out there in the market, and people are concerned about their finance and how they can increase their position in the society on a financial level, economical level, etc. So you're
political
saying...
Political level. Even if they do not make their salah, even if they mix with all kind of things.
Money,
so to prove themselves, the Muslim, you know, they exist in America, and they say...
There was a motto in the old days, money is the key to end all woes, is it?
Yes.
Yeah, so, you know, they believe this and they're into this. Anyway, so in other words, you're saying as a Muslim, we are not supposed to be involved in any type of riba, meaning interest, meaning the word usury. Some people using finance charges.
Lending to get benefit from out of lending the money.
Taking a loan from someone.
Or giving it,
okay,
or witness it,
or
to write
sign,
it.
Sign a contract.
Nothing. Yes.
So Muslim is not supposed to be involved in any of this,
unless
emergency life and death situation.
Exactly.
When it comes to property, when it comes to life, when it comes to one's...
And if anything that you could not really meet the demand of it and became life and death, you're going to lose your family, lose your health, lose your whatever it is, Islam said no. Now we're going to make this red light, green light for you until you pass this situation, and for you only. And after this, everything goes back again red.
So I would like you to please conclude this program. It's getting late, as I see it's 2:15 in the night, not in the morning. Of
this is only the first story.
People say it's 2:15 in the morning, but it's actually 2:15 at night.
Oh.
I'd like you to please close this session by giving us some of the ahadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he has a stern warning about getting involved in this type of transactions.
Since he stated this too late, I think one hadith. If the people really have faith, one hadith is enough, one verse is enough. I'll give you one hadith that I can close with it, which is the meaning of the hadith. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Dirhamun wahid min al-riba ya'kulhu al-rajul wa ya'lam ashad min 36 zanya." This is the meaning of the hadith, it's not exact word. And the hadith is authentic. The Prophet ﷺ said, one dirham, like $1, one currency, this is the currency they use it in that time, dirham. One, let's say dollar, out of usury, that you're receiving it, knowingly that is usury, this is worse in sin than committing adultery, fornication, 36 times. 36 times. So can you imagine, you understand, how this Muslim living in a life of fornication and adultery, and is saying in another narration, talking about that somebody committing adultery with his own mother? Is enough, Allah said, be ready for a war between you and Allah. If you have a war with Allah, how you can be successful? The Muslims, they need to repent to Allah. They need to come back to Allah, and they need to clean themselves, you understand, from all this haram. So when they do like this, Allah will answer them. Otherwise, as the Prophet says, يَمُدُّ يَدَيْهِ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ يَقُولُ يَا رَبْ يَا رَبْ وَمَطْعَمُهُ حَرَامٌ وَمَشْرَبُهُ حَرَامٌ وَمَلْبَسُهُ حَرَامٌ وَغُذِيَ بِالْحَرَامِ فَأَنَّى يُسْتَجَابُ لِذَلِكَ. Person going long journey and saying back, Ya Allah, give me this, give me that, do this for me. The Prophet said, he's eating from haram, drinking from haram, dressing from haram, nourished by haram. How Allah will answer his call? So actually, we need to wake up and see the seriousness of usury, and we pray that this can be a reminder for our viewers that they go really and read the ahadith and the verses about it. And if the people come back to Allah, Allah will suffice them, Allah will take care of them, Allah will enrich them, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will suffice them.
Inshallah, hopefully we get another session of this topic, because there's other scenarios or questions that needs to be answered. For example, if a woman is married to a man and his income comes from this type of source, is it lawful for her to stay with this man and eat from his wealth, live under her house, his house? Or a children who knows that their parents have bought the house on riba, are they allowed to live under these circumstances, etc., etc.? There's many scenarios.
I'm glad that he said this in the later
discussion, inshallah. So we hope that Allah Azza wa Jal gives us, inshallah, life and time that we can indulge ourselves in these subjects. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless both of you and preserve both of you. And we hope and pray that, inshallah, we will see the viewers in the near future with this topic and other topics which will benefit the hearts of the Muslims with the topics of Aqidah, with the topics of the Sunnah, with the topics that concerns them in this life and in the hereafter. وَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ لِي وَلَكُمْ سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُمَّ وَبِحَمْدِكَ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ أَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْكَ.
جزاك الله خيرا. Thank you very much. Thank you.